for New World Order.
Those are the roots of trouble.
I imagine that right now you're feeling a bit like Alice, tumbling down the rabbit hole. Let me tell you why you're here. You're here because you know something. What you know you can't explain, but you feel it. You felt it your entire life, that there's something wrong with the world. You don't know what it is, but it's there, like a splinter in your mind, driving you mad. It is this feeling that has brought you to me. This is your last chance. After this, there is no turning back. You take the blue pill, the story ends. You wake up in your bed and believe whatever you want. You take the red pill, you stay in Wonderland. And I show you how deep the rabbit hole goes. All I'm offering is the truth, nothing more.
For we are opposed around the world by a monolithic and ruthless conspiracy that relies primarily on covert means for expanding its sphere of influence, on infiltration instead of invasion, on subversion instead of elections, on intimidation instead of free choice, on guerrillas by night instead of armies by day. It is a system which has conscripted vast human and material resources into the building of a tightly knit, highly efficient machine that combines military, diplomatic, intelligence, economic, scientific, and political operations. Its preparations are concealed, not published. Its mistakes are buried, not headlined. Its dissenters are silenced, not praised. No expenditure is questioned, no rumor is printed, no secret is revealed. But I am asking your help in the tremendous task of informing and alerting the American people.
And now, welcome to another episode of Down the Rabbit Hole. Here's your host from FederalJack.com. It's Popeye.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to another live edition. It is June 4th, 2014. Man, tonight's going to be interesting. The rest of this week's actually going to be interesting. Tomorrow night, I have Brandon Turberville coming on. He's a writer over at Activist Post, and he's got his own radio show. Just excellent journalist. He's going to come on for 2 hours. I'm going to be picking his brain. And then Friday, Richard Larry Weaver, another USS Liberty survivor, coming on. And then next week I have a bunch of off-air interviews that I've done that I want to try to get aired, at least some of them next week. And probably more the following week. I have Charlotte. I'm going to be interviewing her off-air on Friday before I probably about 2 hours. Yeah, we'll be finished about an hour and a half, 2 hours before I go on with Richard Weaver. I'm going to be on with, I'll be off-air recording an interview for probably anywhere from 2 to 3 hours with Charlotte, like I always do. So just a jam-packed week. That's why I took yesterday off. Just I have so many. I've done so many off-air interviews in the past, I don't know, month, and I've only gotten a chance to, you know, get about one and a half, two of them done and completed and get ready to air for you all. It was like I opened up my virtual closet door and there was a stack of interviews that I had not done yet. You know, the to-do work was much larger than the already done work. So yeah, I'm trying to get caught up because I don't want this stuff to sit for too long and, you know, me forget about it, or I don't get to it for 3 or 4 months because I have so much going on. So I'm trying to make sure I get it all out for you. But yeah, it's going to be an interesting week. Anyway, tonight I want to have, normally, I know sometimes Friday nights I have rant night, but because I'm giving Friday night to Richard Larry Weaver again, I make sure you tune in. If you didn't hear the first time he was on, you can go find it in my archives, but make sure you tune in because he was the most severely injured who survived. He was on fire, and he put the fire out with his own blood. Oh, just, you'll hear it on Friday. It's horrific, and he survived. And the fact that he's able to talk about it and, you know, he's still with us to this day is a testament to his determination as a human being. Anyway, it's going to be an interesting week. So tonight I'm going to be getting into a few things that have been in the news lately that have been pissing me off. And actually, a tidbit of news that came out yesterday that just backs up the pro-gun crowd, I guess you could say. Or I don't like to say the pro-gun crowd because it makes it sound like there's this argument of us versus them. And, I mean, when it comes to the tyrants, yes. But when it comes to each other, it shouldn't be like that. It's done so because, again, everything, and I've talked about this on past broadcasts, you have to go back and listen to the archives, ladies and gentlemen. When I tell you to listen to the archives, I don't do so because I think, you know, I like to hear my, you know, self repeat myself over and over and over again. A lot of times I make mention of something, or I'll say something on air, and I'll make a reference to something, and a lot of times it'll be something that I had mentioned in a previous show, or something I talked about in a previous show. So, always go back and check the archives at Truth Frequency, and then if I mention a show that, you know, was done before the Truth Frequency days, you can go over to federaljack.com. For the listeners out there that don't, you know, maybe aren't technically savvy, you know how to go to links on your phone with your Android phone, right, or your iPhone. Go to the internet search and type in federaljack.com/, that's the one where the slash is leaning to the, where the top of the slash is leaning to the right, federaljack.com/Popeye. It's really easy. federaljack.com/Popeye. And it'll take you right to the archive page, and you can pick whatever show you want, press on it, and it will ask you whether you want to play it with your phone right from the internet, or if you want to download it to your phone or your tablet or whatever. Anyway, past broadcast I'm referring to, I know I took the scenic route, the past broadcast I'm referring to is where I was talking about this choice, the illusion of choice that we're given. In fact, actually, I believe that's the name of the episode. I think that's what I titled it, was the illusion of choice or something like that. Anyway, it's from 2013, if that helps you. That narrows it down by a couple years. So, what is this illusion of choice? Well, any argument, and I'm going to get into the particulars of things, but any argument that is presented to us is always presented in a fashion of it's either A or B, and you can't have anything else other than A or B. So it has to be one of the two. See, they can either control both outcomes or use that same tactic to not only control both outcomes and control a population like they do with elections, but to demonize a certain percentage of the population with the other side of the population and to keep people butting heads and going against each other, divide and conquer. Because if we're at each other's throats, we won't be at theirs. Very simple concept. So, what am I referring to? What am I referring to, at least in this time, when I say this illusion of choice? Well, actually, you'll see tonight there's a lot of it on multiple levels, on a few of the things I'm going to talk about. This illusion of choice where you have to take, you know, one side or the other. So let's start off with one of the first things I want to hop into. We'll just start here and then we can go down the road from there. First, I want to start with, because I'm gonna get into this whole Sergeant Bo Bergdahl thing. I'll get into that later. Because that in and of itself has so many deep levels, I don't want to spend 15 minutes on it. I want to spend at least a segment on it. There's a few things I want to cover. I'm not talking about, well, I have the breaking news from somebody inside his unit. No. Again, that's getting caught down in the particulars of it, and that's not, which are important to know and understand, but it doesn't help you if you stay bogged down in there and you do not pull yourself back out and to look at the bigger picture with this newly acquired information that you got from being inside, you know, or looking deeper, as it were, right? If you get mired down in there, sometimes your aim can get skewered. So, first thing I want to get into, gun control. Now, after this last shooting in California, it was Santa Barbara, whatever it was, everybody's freaking out. Oh my God, we need gun control. We need gun control. The NRA and the politicians are to blame. I'm quoting the father. And by the way, I'm not attacking the father. You know, a lot of people in the alternative media will instantly you know, demonize these people and call them actors. And the guy very well may be. It could be shady, whatnot. You don't know. Okay, from what I could see, maybe the kid, you know, to me it looks like he was very troubled, the child. And maybe it actually was a real event, not some stage event. It could be. I don't know. Maybe it is a staged event. I haven't looked that deep into this particular event. Okay, I've been juggling a ton of other things. But from what I have seen of it so far, okay, I don't need to know whether or not it was a controlled event or a real event to know what the powers that shouldn't be are doing with it. Okay? And the reason I say it might not be a controlled event is because the mass media coverage is now over it. See, at the time, it happened during this big VA scandal, and it helped to take some of the heat off the VA scandal. And then so did the whole Bo Bergdahl thing. See, you see how the media is used to manipulate your public opinion and what you're paying attention to? That's why you have to stop paying attention to what the media is reporting. Because they're the ones leading you around by the nose. Okay? Think of yourself like a dog in this situation and the media as the human with the steak. The steak can be whatever they want to feed you. It could be the truth. It could be lies. Whatever they choose to feed you. And that's how they control the public. That's why they have news cycles and everything else. It's very, 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 very deep, ladies and gentlemen. The rabbit hole. That's why this journey down into it with me takes years. And it'll be a journey that will never stop as long as I breathe and I keep doing this. Because none of us will ever stop learning. Anyway, so gun control. Where am I going with this? Well, after this shooting slash stabbing, because I don't want to just say mass shooting. After this shooting slash stabbing, and I discussed this last week, there's all these calls for gun control. My God, we need gun control, man. We just can't have this anymore. You see all these bills being pushed, you know, gun control bills being pushed back in again by lawmakers, which they didn't just write them. This stuff was sitting in a drawer waiting for something to happen, which they do. Sometimes that something happens because they made it happen. Sometimes it just happens and then they act on it. Like Rahm Emanuel said, never let a good crisis go to waste, right? So, again, it's this premise of, oh my God, crazy people are going to get guns, and if they didn't have such easy access to guns, then there wouldn't have been a problem. Like I said last week, it was either CNN or MSNBC. They asked the gun store owner, do you feel a little bit guilty that the guy, you know, killed three people with a gun he bought from you? And the gun store owner was like, no, I don't. We sell instruments. The guy, you know, unfortunately, he passed all the background checks, but unfortunately, he used it to do evil. You know, does the local hardware store or Home Depot feel bad if someone goes in and buys a hammer and a hacksaw and goes home and beats their wife to death with a hammer and then hacks her body up with the hacksaw and puts her in garbage bags? Do they go to the local Home Depot where it was purchased and ask the manager of the Home Depot, sir, do you feel maybe you're partly responsible for this? See, that's CNN. That's the media, by the way, trying to frame the argument. They're not even really trying to frame that guy in particular, like a frame up. They're framing the argument of the gun store owners are responsible for violence caused by guns that they sell. Well, if that's the case, then people that get in car accidents should be, or families that are killed in car accidents should be able to sue the car manufacturer of the car that hit them. Where does it stop? Where does the not taking any personal responsibility train stop once it's left the station? Because that's what the media, the government, and everybody else wants you to believe. You can't take personal responsibility or accountability. It can't be the person who actually did it's fault. No, it's everybody else's fault. Let's blame everybody else but the whack job that took the gun and the knife and killed people. And see, there's one of the most important parts. We need gun control. What about knife control? I said this the other day, and this is an important point again, and you'll see why in a second. Where's the knife control? Where are the calls for knife control? I made this statement on a YouTube video about the shooting, and a lot of the comments I got arguing against what I said were saying to me that even though I had a valid point, they wouldn't acquiesce to the fact that I had won the debate with logic. So they would say, even though my point is valid and that they were committing logical fallacies, it doesn't matter. I have to admit, and they kept saying, but you have to admit that guns are more dangerous and deadlier than a knife. And I said, only in the hands of the person who's using it. And they said, that's not a valid argument. I said, oh, it most certainly is a valid argument. I know some people that can't fight worth a damn. And even with a knife, the only weapon that would benefit them to be holding would be a firearm, because they could fire it from a distance and back up. They really don't know anything about hand-to-hand combat, or they're not a scrapper, and they've never punched somebody in the face or taken a punch to the face. That's the most important part about learning how to fight, is being able to take a punch to the face. First time you get clocked in the face, it gets rid of that fear of getting hit in the face, and you don't have it no more. It's like riding a motorcycle or anything else. First time you do it, okay, fear over. So it really depends on whose hands the weapon is in. There are people that they're such good fighters, martial arts, Krav Maga, whatever. Their hands are registered weapons. Literally, their hands are registered weapons. So they can't fight, because if they do, they can go to jail because their hands are weapons. Should we have hand control? What happens if that guy got in a fight and killed 15 people because he just started breaking necks? Well, what do we do? Anybody that knows how to fight or does martial arts, we start locking them up? Well, no, they'll still be able to fight and they could fight their way out. Well, I guess we have to chop their hands off. Little chop, chop, square, as Joe would say. I guess that's what we got to do, like they do in the Middle East, you know, where they heat the blade up so it cauterizes it as it comes down. Is that what we're going to do? Well, that's insane, Popeye! Okay, so's confiscating guns from everybody, or attempting to, because that wouldn't work out well, just so you know. The Japanese wouldn't invade during World War II. Admiral Yamamoto, the architect of the invasion of Pearl Harbor, and I quote, "I would not dream of invading mainland America, for there would be a gun behind every blade of grass," end quote. Well, so the guy that had the balls to attack Pearl Harbor and was the architect of that attack wouldn't have invaded the mainland United States, because he knew that would be a bad idea. And yet our own government's like, let's go take guns from the gun owners. Yeah. You people really need a history lesson, just so you know. Now, where are the calls for knife control? The guy in the shooting at the college a couple weeks ago stabbed 3 out of the 6 people. So 50% of the people killed in this mass murder that they're using to justify gun control, or a push for gun control, and the push, the emotional push. Remember, it's also about, you know, people say, well, you know, look, it didn't happen again. Ha ha, we want our rights. No, they're building up in the general emotional consensus of the public. Every time one of these happens, you see more and more people, we need to just ban guns and get rid of them altogether. Because now it's not assault rifles, because, you know, now it's even pistols, shotguns, right? Of course, this violence happens every day. There's over 350 million people in this country. They just pick up certain stories and then report on it and report on it and report on it. Remember, the news, the cable news networks are what make a lot of this news go viral. So anyway, Knife control. We need knife control. We need knife control now. That's insane, Popeye. We can't have knife control. But he stabbed 3 out of the 6 people. Well, so we should ban guns because he shot 3 of them. But that's not a valid argument either. If my argument of we should ban knives because the guy stabbed 3 people is totally invalid and irrational, then how come yours isn't? Because you're saying it and because it's a gun? What's the difference between a knife and a gun? I don't want to hear the obvious that one shoots bullets and one doesn't. There are some knives, by the way, that can shoot, so ha-ha. But I digress. What is the difference besides the obvious mechanical functioning? What the definition of either of both of them is a weapon. The definition of a knife is a weapon, or could be. The definition of a gun is a weapon. So they're both weapons. They're both deadly. If I stab you in the neck, you're going to bleed. If I stab you in the chest, the face, whatever, you're going to bleed. Just as much as if I shoot you. Now, granted, I can shoot you from I can hit you from a further distance or assault you from a further distance with a firearm because it shoots a projectile. Now, if you really want to get into semantics, I mean, what are we going to go back a couple thousand years to when they first figured out, when mankind figured out that throwing projectiles at each other was actually smarter than running up and trying to stab one another or hit each other with rocks? I mean, actually, if you want to get technical, it was probably the first caveman that was standing watching two guys smash each other in the face with rocks until they both fell down that went, "That's kind of stupid," and just picked up the rock and hurled it 15 feet at his opponent, hitting him in the head and knocking him down, and went, "Well, that was much easier." Well, now you have a projectile instead of a handheld weapon, which is basically the difference between a gun and a knife. One shoots the projectile, which would allow for close and distance, and the other one, well, and unless you're Jason Statham in the Expendables, or somebody that has, you know, that type of knife-throwing abilities, at least his character in the movie, you'd understand what I'm talking about. You're not going to be hurling knives, or unless you have ninja stars in your pocket. I mean, maybe you do. Maybe you have throwing knives. There are throwing knives. Now, there are knives that are, you know, then what is that? Is that any less deadly than a bullet? If I have a belt of throwing knives, and I'm an assassin, and I know how to hurl the knives out with the flick of a wrist, and I could hit you in the throat with the knife before you could even reach for your gun that's in your holster right on your hip, free and open, does that make my knife any less deadlier than your gun? No, it doesn't. It makes you dead. That's what it makes you. So this semantical argument, and well, a knife is deadlier, and a knife is not as deadly as a gun. It's relative to who's using it. I know people that even with a gun in their hands, they wouldn't be deadly because they shouldn't be holding the gun. The only danger they really are is to themselves because they certainly aren't going to hit what they're trying to shoot. And then I know people that with their bare hands could disarm somebody with a gun and a knife and make them eat it. Is he any less deadly? I have a friend who's special forces who could literally, and I'm not kidding you, you could be double fisting with your fingers on the trigger, and I'm willing to bet money, and anybody that knows me knows I don't bet money unless I know I'm going to win. I'd be willing to bet money that he would take both guns out of your hand and make you eat them before you could even get a round off on him. You're going to tell me he's not deadly with his hands and the training he's got? Explain that to me. Logically, of course, because you can't. It's stupid. And then now you have a knife attack in a school where these two 16-year-old girls wanted to stab another 16-year-old girl. Maybe they were 12, whatever the hell they were. They were teenage girls, and they read fan fiction online, horror fan fiction. And for whatever reason, they were inspired by some of the weird stories they read. You can't blame the stories. You have to blame the person. Again, personal responsibility. But they lured their friend out into the woods by where this park area. And then they tackled her and proceeded to stab this girl 19 times. The only reason why she's still alive is because they were a millimeter away from, I believe it was her heart. She almost had a near fatal, I mean, she almost died anyway from the stab wounds because it did nick a couple organs. Where's all the moms against knives? Where's all the women on TV? This will not stand anymore. Oh, because it was two girls killing another girl. Oh, so that's okay. Was that like feminism at work? Women power. Yes, I was being facetious. Why are you not calling for knife control? How come there aren't people? How come this girl's parents, the one that was stabbed, how come CNN didn't go rushing to their house? Can we talk to you? Can we get your thoughts? Do you want knife control? Do you have anything to say to the NRA? Oh, wait a minute. They don't regulate knives. Or they don't. Well, the NRA doesn't really regulate anything, but they don't advocate for knives. Yeah, because there's really no political football for banning knives, is there? Because it also sounds insane, because it would not solve a problem. A little one-sided, if you ask me. Anyway, we'll get back into it. Stay tuned. Break coming up. Don't go anywhere. So we are back. I'm harping on knife control because I'm tired of senseless knife crime. So I'm going to start my own group called Radio Show Hosts for Total and Complete Knife Control. Radio Show Hosts for Total and Complete Knife Control. Now, if somebody could make a meme, one of the listeners could make a meme, make a little acronym out of that. Maybe put like a butcher knife with like a Picatinny rail on it. Maybe I don't know, extendable handle or something. No more knives. The dreaded assault knife. It's not even that they're going after the quote unquote assault rifles, which they still blame them for things. But now it's just any gun. And I talked about this when this hardcore push for gun control came out a couple years back. Or I should say the latest hardcore push, right? And they started blaming just the assault rifles and AK-47s and AR-15s. And I said, well, and I wasn't the only one, by the way, but a lot of us said, hey, you watch, they're going to come after other guns too. And I would play clips and point out, look, they're not talking about AR-15s now. They're talking about pistols now. They're talking about shotguns, regular hunting rifles. Well, why stop there? Total and complete knife control. Again, Radio Show Hosts for Total and Complete Knife Control. I don't think it's right that you should be able to go to Walmart or Kmart or Target or James Way or whatever other store happens to be around you. I think James Way's out of business. I don't think there are any of those around anymore. God, I just aged myself. Anyway, I don't think you should be able to go there and buy one of those knife blocks. The little wooden block with the whole knife set in it. That's the assault knife set. You get multiple knives. That's a high-capacity knife magazine. Usually, what do those things come with? You usually get like 5 or 7 steak knives, a paring knife, a filleting knife, a bread knife, and like 1 or 2 butcher knives. So you're looking at maybe 10 or 12 piece knife set. Isn't that a high-capacity knife magazine right there? Should those be able to be purchased without a permit? I don't think so. I think not only should you have to have a permit, I think you need to have a license. And I think the only sensible people to run that whole thing would be the government, because they know how to control themselves when it comes to using weapons on people. The pause was so you would understand it was complete sarcasm. High-capacity knife magazines. That would be a meme. Listeners! It's just insane, ladies and gentlemen. Come on. Use your brain for a minute. Think about it. When I say insane things like that to you, we need to ban going to Target and being able to buy a wood, you know, the knife sets with the wooden block where you can put it on your counter and easily have the knife sitting. Why is that okay? People are stabbing each other. Again, I'll go back to this story with these little girls. And I'm going to play a clip from CNN just because I want to make fun of CNN's reporting a little bit on this subject. But and I'm going to get into this thing a little bit here so I can explain it a little bit better. But again, where is the knife control? These girls were just as disturbed, equally as disturbed as this young man that went on this knifing / shooting spree. And yet, I don't hear any calls for knife control from that, and I certainly don't even hear any calls for knife control from this. I do see blame being passed on other people. And before I get into this, because this is going to, although this covers it, and I want to show you an example of, you know, how these girls were twisted, and I want to make fun of CNN for a second. I need to just point out again that I do not see anybody screaming and yelling at all, to ban knives. And I'm going to keep repeating that, because that's all you hear from the mainstreams: ban guns, ban guns, ban guns, ban guns. Guns are not any more lethal than a knife. They can both kill you. Tasers kill people. As far as I'm concerned, they're just as lethal as a firearm. They've killed enough people. That's why they don't call them non-lethal anymore. They call them less than lethal. Or less lethal. They can't even say less than lethal because they kill people, so they call them less lethal. That kind of creates a gray area. Yes, if I was an armorer, by the way, and I was outfitting my men for warfare, yeah, okay, I wouldn't just give them knives and say, go run into a gunfight with a knife, because I would want them to have the exact same weaponry, okay? Because they would have projectiles being hurled at them. So it would be stupid for me to just tell them to run into the hail of gunfire. But you could still send highly trained men, even if they didn't have guns, in there with knives, and I'll bet you if you sent the right individuals, they could take out a lot of people with just a knife. Maybe they could, you know, you tell them you could take their weapons, you just can't have your own, like a video game. I mean, that's kind of the argument that people get into, by the way, with this crap. You get mired down into the particulars of something, right? Which, again, knowing the particulars are important, but if you're getting dragged into a logical fallacy-filled argument, you need to stop it and end it so you don't get dragged into that false debate to begin with, because then it's going to delay. It's going to eventually wear you out, you know, mentally, because a lot of people aren't ready for that. And, you know, if you get caught in this fight and then you actually get caught up in it, you'll, before you know it, you're arguing for 15, 20 minutes. And you're like, I don't want to talk about this anymore, which is the whole point of throwing logical fallacies out there. It's to misdirect and then end the argument. So, again, when someone comes at you with something like, well, we need gun control but no knife control, well, that doesn't make any sense to me. Again, it doesn't make an ounce of sense that this young man, in the same murder that people were screaming for gun control, knifed the same amount of people he shot, stabbed them to death. Apparently, the gun, in this case, was just as lethal as the knife, and apparently, the knife with the knife in the case of these two girls was just as lethal, because this young lady almost died. And I don't want to hear, well, she didn't die, Popeye. Okay, she didn't die by the grace of God. And even everybody involved in the case, the doctors, everybody, the cops, parents, everybody has said she's lucky to be alive. Okay? She almost did die. And again, it was in the hands of the user. Two separate sets of individuals. He killed three people with a knife, and these two almost killed one person with a knife. Same weapon, different amount of dead bodies. In one case, it was one person killing three, and in the other case, it was two people trying to kill one. The knife was deadly in both cases, almost deadly in the second. But do you see how in different hands? Yes. That's where you get your varying degrees of whether or not the weapon is deadly or not. Look, when I was in the Coast Guard, I trained people how to shoot. It was one of my jobs. Okay, I worked in the armory. I could put a round up a flea's ass at 300 yards. Okay, I qualified expert. My name's on the wall. Still's there. Listen to me, still's there. What school did you went, Popeye? It's still there. So when I was teaching people how to shoot, I can attest to the fact that there are people that should not be holding firearms. You're right. There are just some people that they, you know, until maybe they grow up or maybe get a new brain, they shouldn't have a firearm. But those people that are bumbling like that are usually they're pretty easy to spot, especially when you get them on the range. So yeah, I agree that there are people that shouldn't have firearms because they would probably shoot their own foot off and they would be nowhere near as deadly to the enemy as they would be to themselves. And it's the same thing with a knife. I also know people that are like that with cars, that they shouldn't be driving, period. Again, is it the vehicle? Is it the car that makes somebody lose their mind and drive into a crowd of individuals, like a crowded farmer's market or something, and kill 15 people or whatever? Does the family sue Chevy? Or who, you know, whatever model company the car happens to be? Do they sue them? Do they sue the shoe company for the shoes the guy who was driving the car was wearing because his foot was on the gas pedal, so it's obviously the shoemaker's fault? I mean, it makes total sense to sue the shoe company because the guy was wearing those shoes when he was driving. I mean, let's be honest, it's not his fault. It's the shoe company's fault. If the guy wasn't wearing uncomfortable shoes, he wouldn't have gotten a bunion, and it wouldn't have pissed him off, and he wouldn't have wanted to mow 15 people down, right? And the other thing I wanted to get into before I get into the stabbing thing here with the two young ladies was, where's the call for police brutality control or gun control for the cops or grenade control for the cops or SWAT team control for the cops? Where's the call for cop control in general? All these moms on TV, this is not right, ban guns, ban guns, ban guns, this guy's father, ban guns, it's the NRA and politicians' fault. It's everybody else's fault but that one lone individual who actually went out and acted out, because that's where the responsibility actually lies. And maybe somewhat in the fact that the cops actually went there, and then, you know, they his family said, you know, we think, you know, we're worried, blah, 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 blah. You can go research the case. The point is, personal responsibility, right? So, how come everybody wants to blame the gun and there's all outrage in that case, but when cops throw a flashbang grenade into a crib, burning a little boy's face and putting him in a coma, he's in a coma right now, medically induced because of everything, have no idea what kind of damage this little man's going to have for the rest of his life. They threw a flashbang grenade into his crib. And their excuse was, well, we didn't know that there was a kid inside or we wouldn't have done it. And we didn't mean to. It was an accident. We know better for next time. And they cleared themselves of any wrongdoing. Where's the call for flashbang control for the cops? Or SWAT raid control for the cops? They shoot kids, dogs, and people all the time during these SWAT raids, especially when they raid the wrong friggin' house or the wrong apartment. They didn't do their due diligence. They did a quick drive-by, like 5 minutes before they raided the house. They didn't even have anybody sitting outside for a few hours to monitor the situation and see what was going on. They hadn't even been monitoring it for days, like you would think. I did more monitoring and more investigative work as a private investigator on each one of my cases than these D-bags did before they raided that house and dropped a grenade, because that's what it is. It's a flashbang grenade. They dropped an incendiary device into the crib of a child. Where is the call for SWAT team control? Where's the call for SWAT control? I don't see that. I don't see outraged parents on news networks. I see the parents of the child being interviewed, but I don't see moms across America for gun control or whatever the frig their group name is. I don't see them coming out and saying, you know, we need SWAT raid control. How come it's okay only for the police and the military to have guns, yet every day you turn on the TV, it's the police that are doing killing? You have a better chance of being killed by a police officer in this country than by a terrorist or a law-abiding, legal gun owner. You have a better chance of getting killed by the guy that you think is going to come and protect you, because that's what you've been told. Because he's got a costume on and I'm supposed to go to him. Think about that for a second. Think. Use that supercomputer that you have in your skull. Use it. You're not as stupid as the powers that shouldn't be think you are and want you to believe you are. And you know what? If you're ignorant to something, don't let that hold you back. Learn. You won't be ignorant anymore, will you? And then that'll boost your self-confidence, don't you think? Well, I'm not ignorant to this anymore. And then you can have conversations with people, and if they're ignorant to the facts, while you're talking to them, you'll realize it, and you'll probably feel better about yourself, won't you? Anyway, back to the stabbing, and then I want to move on to the Bo Bergdahl thing. So, because we got about 10 minutes left, so I want to finish up with this. And try to fit in a video clip really quick. If not, I'll play it before the end of the show. Andrew Demeter, he's a young teenager. He's a good kid and a fellow activist. Very young, starting off young, and it's good. Smart kid, quick thinker, and he confronted Nancy Pelosi, and he sent me the video, and I wanted to play it for you guys. It's like a minute and 17 seconds, but you can hear her tripping up on her own words, and, you know, he's like 17-year-old kid, you know, knocking him down. Right, way to go. Anyway, so to finish up my point about this whole knife control versus gun control, obviously the knife control thing is it's me being facetious and proving a point, or not even being facetious. It's me actually – well, maybe a little bit of facetiousness, but using logic to point out that it's just insane what they're trying to get you to think. Remember, they spend millions and millions and millions of millions and millions of dollars putting on all these different people on all these, you know, CNN, MSNBC, calling for knife control, or excuse me, calling for gun control all the time, you know. And they only give that voice of the argument, so it sounds like the whole nation is crying out for this. And it's the way the argument is presented to you. Again, it's a logical fallacy. It's presented different, you know, different ways. It's manipulative, and it's not correct. And that's why you tune into me and other radio show hosts and, you know, people that put out like vlogs and stuff, because you're tired of their lies. It's that simple. Anyway, so this stabbing thing, right? I want to play this a little bit of this clip really quick from these two girls. If you don't know what I'm talking about, it'll give you a little bit of background on it. And I just want to throw a few things in here really quick, but I'll let it play. So these two girls, they try to kill their friend, right? And again, you know all this background about the case in California. So let me give you a little bit of background on the case that I've been, this other case that I've been talking about, since I've been using it as an example.
I've been here for over 24 years as a cop in the city of Waukesha, and I have not seen a crime of this nature, especially when you take into account it was 12-year-old girls.
12-year-old Morgan Guys.
You see, I was right. They were 12. First, I said they were 16, but they're 12. Anyway, back to the audio.
...and Anissa Weyer are accused of attempted murder of their 12-year-old friend when police say they lured her into the woods and stabbed her 19 times, leaving her for dead.
These are the woods where the stabbing actually happened. It's several blocks away from the park where all of this began. The victim was able to get to this area here where the bicyclist found her nearly dead.
She was within a millimeter of her life. She was within a millimeter of one of the stab wounds striking a major artery to her heart, along with the other 18 stab wounds that she had.
Police say Geyser and Wire plotted for months the best way to kill their friend. According to authorities, they first plotted to duct tape her mouth and stab her in the neck, then change their...
Which, by the way, that would be pretty lethal. Just for the people that want to say that knives are less lethal than guns, I'm pretty sure if you get stabbed in the neck, it's not less lethal than a gun. Just saying.
Plans to lure her into the woods while playing a game of hide-and-seek. The motive, say police, to win the favor of a fictional internet horror character called Slenderman.
Slenderman. Not Slender Man, which is what his name is. Slenderman. So now you're changing his religious beliefs, perhaps, / ethnicity? It's a joke, ladies and gentlemen. Anybody would get the joke, some people won't. Anyway, it's not Slenderman. Slender Man. Slender Man. Slender Man is an internet meme, horror character. Well, it was a meme. I guess you could say it was a meme that turned into a horror character. It started back in 2009. It was like this, I want to say like a contest / like, I don't know, like a joke contest. You could go look it up. It's hard to describe, but we'll just say it was a contest. If I remember correctly, it really wasn't for money. It was just like a contest, you know, amongst people messing around, joking around, whatever, with Photoshop. And if I remember correctly, they were supposed to make the creepiest image, and they were taking real photos. I think the rule of the contest was they had to use real photos to make the creepy images. And this one guy took a picture. He used a picture of his kids playing on a playground, and around one of the pieces of playground equipment, he had created this tall, slender, faceless character that almost appeared to be wearing like a black suit. Like the Men in Black type suit, but a very tall, skinny version of that. Faceless, almost. Kind of off in the corner watching the kids. You know, like, very menacing. The way he did it gave off this menacing aura of this, you know, monster. And it became an internet meme, and quickly they turned it, you know, like horror fan fiction and stuff. And you're going to hear in the clip, you're going to hear them mention something called creepypasta. And creepypasta is, it's a subgenre of copypasta, which is nothing more than people, like if you've ever been on Reddit, it's copy and pasting blocks of information. So somebody will, you know, maybe post something on a Reddit forum, and then somebody copies that and pastes underneath and responds to it, and then somebody copies both those. That's the basic idea for the people who don't understand it. Copypasta. That's the little internet name for what that's called. Well, creepypasta is a subgenre of that, which consists of short horror fiction and urban legends. Urban legends, which they get spread around by like online message boards and forums and stuff. Now, urban legends have been around for pretty much as long as man could talk to each other and pass, you know, communicate, besides going, you know what I mean? besides scratching our heads and looking at each other and trying to point at stuff, yeah, urban legends have been around for a very long time. So Slender Man is one of these creepy, you know, like scary stories. And these girls were inspired by some of the stories that they had seen about children being killed, and they decided to act on these impulses. You really can't blame the fan fiction, the internet, or Slender Man. You have to blame the two little psychos that plotted for months. So it wasn't really an impulse thing. They plotted for months to kill their friend, and they decided the best way to do it was the bathrooms because there was a drain for the blood to go down. So maybe we should be questioning what's wrong with the girls. Maybe we should start taking a look at their history. Any good profiler knows anything about serial killers or difference between serial killers and mass murderers would understand. That's why I'm going to do a show about serial killers. Anyway, let me try to finish up this clip really quick. I wanted to make fun of CNN. It's Slenderman. Slender Man. Idiot. Can't even do their research and pronounce things correctly.
Who the girls found on the horror fantasy website, creepypasta.wikia.com.
It's not wikia.wiki.
Well, Slender Man was a fictional character that was created as part of a joke back in 2009. And most of his representation, Slender Man, is this thin, tall, faceless character. Now, the creepy part about the character is, in most stories, he kills children.
The Creepypasta website is one venue for this Slender Man character, but as I started looking into it, he's everywhere.
Yes.
Is there a sense that they were reading about him and studying him in various forms online, not just Creepypasta?
That's still being investigated as far as all their internet sites. Obviously, we're doing the computer forensic evidence of their computers and such. I would assume that it will turn out to be more than just Creepypasta, but all sites have to be of concern to parents.
Well, gee, thanks for that. I mean, you see how the reporter doesn't even know what he's talking about. So do you think it's him? Do you think they're learning about him? Oh my God, teenagers are going to be, they're going to be worshiping Slender Man and try to kill. No, stop it. You're not addressing the problem. You're using fear and sensationalism, and you have so much ignorance based, you don't have any knowledge based off of your ignorance of the subject, and you're just scaring people because it's sensationalistic. If you don't know what you're talking about, don't do a news report on it, okay? Again, banning the knife or the gun or anything would not have stopped either of these murders because they would have found another way to do it. It's that simple.
This is Sparta!
But let's not solve the problem. Let's just handle the symptom. Typical way that they handle things here. All right, hour one up, hour two coming up. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back. Going to get into Sergeant Bo Bergdahl. Stay tuned. Ladies and gentlemen, we are back with hour number two here on tonight's live edition of Down the Rabbit Hole. I am your host, Popeye from FederalJack.com. So, hour two. By the way, if you missed hour one, go back and listen to it. If you did, by the way, hear it, I urge you to have that conversation about knife control versus gun control with somebody that you know that is against guns because of their fear-based ignorance on the subject and the brainwashing. Sit down with them and don't, you know, try to keep it obviously logic filled, but I urge you to try to have that same debate and try to point out, you know, that fact to them. See how that works. Let me know. So hour two, I said I was going to get into two things. I wanted to get into Bo Bergdahl, and I want to get into I'm going to talk about the war. So I know it's going to end up, I'm going to end up going off and it, you know, it's going to take me, who knows where it'll take me. So, before we get into that, I did say that I would play this clip from Andrew Demeter really quick. Again, he's a, if I remember correctly, Andrew's 17 years old. Very young for an activist. what a lot of people in my age group would be in that age group that people in my age group or my generation would consider to be that lost cause generation. A lot of people say, "Oh, the young ones are so dumb; they don't know anything." Well, Andrew and his friends will make you think twice about that. They most certainly will. Let me play this clip really quick. They were in Washington, and they got a chance. And I don't know the exact particulars. I'll have to see if I can get him. Maybe bring Andrew on the show and ask him, interview him. But they were in Washington. They were in Nancy Pelosi's, we'll say, either in her office or, around her office. And they were able to have a conversation with her. And during this conversation, Andrew asked her point blank to her face why she supports the NSA's illegal spying and, wiretapping of the American public, which she does. She voted to support them financially by, keep continuing funding them. And if she was outraged, where's the outrage? And she wasn't outraged. I mean, go back and look at the comments that she made. So anyway, I'll let Andrew have the floor. It's about a minute and a half. Check this out. Again, ladies and gentlemen, this is the youth of today. This is what inspires me when I hear and see things like this. Look him up, Andrew Demeter. He's a really cool kid. His last name is spelled D-E-M-E-T-E-R. Look him up on Facebook.
Why do you support the NSA's illegal and ubiquitous data collection?
Well, I do not. I have questions about the metadata collection that they were collecting, unless they had a reason to do so. I didn't support Amash, that resolution. I didn't think that was the appropriate resolution. But I do think that the burden is on the department, and I have fought them for years, on the community, fought them for years on the wide swath that they have put out there.
You did vote for a bill to continue funding for the NSA, though.
Yeah, of course. I don't think we should not fund the National Security Agency. No, they do many, things.
Isn't the NSA a clear violation of the Fourth Amendment?
No. Some of what they do should be subjected to scrutiny in some of the things, but they perform many.
So she's decided, by the way, even though that's not for her to decide if the NSA has violated the Fourth Amendment. Actually, the courts, technically, I mean, if you're going to go, judicial, legislative, the three branches, executive, they pass the laws and stuff, but, I mean, yeah, they could have hearings and stuff on it and, maybe recommend things or whatnot, but if this went to court, the Supreme Court or a judge would decide on whether or not it was a violation of the Fourth Amendment. Last time I checked, you didn't have the authority, Nancy, to be deciding whether anything violated any of the amendments. I mean, you like that? No, I don't think it violated the Fourth Amendment. So, no. That's why, but it did. But no, it didn't. Trust me. Young man, I know what I'm talking about. I'm Nancy Pelosi. Ugh, can't stand her.
Other functions as well, and we hold them to a high order. And I've had my biggest fights here than in the intelligence community with the director of the NSA, Hayden, when he was the director. I don't think he was on the level with us. But that doesn't mean that there aren't other things that are there that are good things that are necessary for us to have. But from 9/11 on, the Bush administration went too far on all of these things, and we have the correspondence back and forth to prove or to demonstrate that they were just doing the wrong thing.
So, when in doubt, don't blame the current administration or the current people in the NSA. No, they're fine. We have some questions. We've had some arguments. But you know what? It's Hayden's fault. Bush appointee. Yeah, it's all Hayden's fault. Mm-hmm. And, I mean, he is I do not like him. I've taken him to the woodshed before on the broadcast. But, really? It's all his fault? It's the Bush administration. I don't agree with that. You see how she didn't really answer his questions? A 17-year-old made Nancy Pelosi uncomfortable in her own shoes and in her own skin while getting questioned in front of those cameras. Well done, Andrew. Well done. Bravo Zulu, young man. Ugh. Ugh. Cannot stand Nancy Pelosi. I absolutely, positively cannot stand her. I'm going to have to get Andrew on. I'll have to interview him. That'll be interesting, to say the least. Smart kid. Very smart kid. Gives you hope. Well done, young man. We need more people like him. Anyway, I want to rant about this whole, getting my stuff here together for you. I want to go off. There's like six different ways that you could cover this whole thing, this whole mess, as it were, with Bo Bergdahl. Now, in hour one, I was talking about the illusion of choice, remember? And I said that I would show you how in both cases you're only given a choice A or a choice B. It's like that with actually a lot of stuff, right? Well, the argument being presented, at least from what I see, and it could have been a very... It could have been a very organic thing, which some of the anger is organic, but you'll see in a second. My brain has been analyzing this for the past couple of days. So, Bo Bergdahl, prisoner of war, been prisoner of war since 2009, MIA since 2009, POW. The Taliban and the official... I actually have to see, I don't know what the official, I actually don't want to say what the official government story is, because I don't know what their official version is. I mean, even they have questions, and I don't know what they have officially written on paper. As opposed to what's been said by the media, I'd like to actually see what's on paper. But they always say, well, the details are sketchy. Well, maybe sketchy for the news media, but according to his fellow soldiers, he... basically, you know, being part of the team, you know, when you're at a forward operating base or even a little outpost, whatever, out in the middle of nowhere, you know, in a hostile country, because you're, you know, you're at war with whoever in that country, you all do security patrols. You all rely on one another. Bergdahl obviously knew where the cracks and the security were, and he knew how to get out. And he did. Now, a lot of people are attacking him for leaving. And this is where, again, this illusion of choice, side A or side B, comes up. And I see the media and other people, to a certain extent, kind of, whether it was done on purpose, which I'll get into, or whether it's just the media, you know, taking something and working it like they do, like Play-Doh or Silly Putty. I see it turning into this big prick-waving dick fight of, it's awesome to be a soldier or a Marine or an airman or a sailor, and it's awesome to go kill, and war is cool. That's what I see. I see this turning into a huge recruiting poster for the military. To a certain extent. And again, that could be organic. It could be done on purpose. I mean, I'll throw both, you know, views out there. But I say that because there's a lot of people in the military community that are pissed off that Bergdahl was being portrayed as this hero, because there was a lot of soldiers that died while looking for him. So his actions, again, his personal actions cost the life of other human beings. So if he wasn't kidnapped and he did walk off that base voluntarily, okay, whether or not he was you know, I don't want to fight with the enemy anymore because I see what we're doing to the people of Afghanistan and we're killing innocent kids and stuff with drone strikes. And but I concur. I wholeheartedly agree that that's bad stuff. But you also have to take into account you're in a hostile area with your fellow soldiers. They rely on you for their safety as you rely on them for yours. And you know that if you go out beyond the wire and you go AWOL or MIA, they're going to go looking for you because they're not just going to be like, oh, well, screw them. So you know now they're going to be putting their lives in danger. So there is personal accountability that has to be had for that. Okay. So I understand the emotional end from the military, the military side of it. Veterans and guys that might still be in that are pissed off. I'm a vet myself. I get it. But what I see is that genuine, organic, very justified emotion being twisted, and this argument of war is good and it's good to serve and do whatever, and he's a traitor to his country because he abandon his unit. Well, yes, that is treason under the, you know, if you read the UCMJ and you look up the definition, what he did could be considered treasonous. But what I see to a certain extent is the media picking that up and blowing it more up out of proportion. So that way they're creating this event of yes, he's a POW, they brought him back, and Obama's bad, you know, this whole swap thing, broke laws, everything else, you know, poo-poo on Bo Bergdahl. But then, at the same time, it's awesome to be a soldier and fight with honor and dignity, protecting this country and the Constitution and the people in it, because, yeah, we're in another country, and that's what I see being pushed by the media right now. Now, there's another side to this whole Bo Bergdahl thing, which I'll get into in a minute. But the reason I say it's not cool what they're doing, okay, and I see them pushing this propaganda for war, because I have a lot of friends that are ex-military, you know, former military, retired military, I should say. Not ex, because that would imply they got kicked out. And I've had this discussion with some of my friends, you know, off air through emails and stuff. And some of them, you know, are heated and everything, and I completely understand. But I think that raw emotion via the media is being twisted to a certain extent, and by others, by people who would benefit from people being mad at each other and from pushing the idea, that false patriotic idea that it's good to send your kids to serve and die in someone else's backyard for bullshit. And that's what I see happening. I see this false narrative. There's a lot of things going on with it. So that's one of the things. And I see people being divided because you have people saying, you know, screw him. You know, he's a traitor. And the answer to that, here's the opposite side, the choice B of it, right? The only other option is you'll have the people saying, well, you know, he was a, you know, he didn't want to fight anymore. And, you know, good for him. There's other people that have defected and gone AWOL in other wars. And that's the truth. They have. Okay? And I'm totally down with being a conscientious objector and all that, okay? But the point is, they're taking those two sides, okay, which both are valid points, okay? But, and they're pinning, it's being pitted against each other, right? So now you can't be patriotic, and you must be a D-bag if you would walk off, or not even walk off, if you don't agree with what was going on, if you're not America. That's what the media is twisting it into. That's a lot of the narrative that's being, I see, you know, different bloggers, or, and it's being picked up by people that, you know, might have websites or YouTube stuff that might be ex-military, but they're very like they're still drinking the patriotic Kool-Aid, and I see a lot of it. You know, it's this two-sided argument, and that's not really a two-sided argument. That's a fake two-sided argument. That's not accurate at all. Yes, I understand why those soldiers would be pissed off, and rightfully so. They're correct. But I also understand how he could feel about walking off. But the difference is, and this is what one of the guys that pointed this out, he was being interviewed by CNN. He said, you know, a lot of us had those same feelings. We didn't think we should be there, but we didn't walk away and leave our friends. And then, which he, Bergdahl, knew that by doing that, they would go out and look for him, and that would put more people in danger. You're just making the problem worse. Maybe the guy was not in his right frame of mind when he walked off. I mean, he could have been just totally stressed out and PTSD kicked in, and maybe his brain was just, I'm done. I mean, this whole being a deserter and I'm a hero and no one ever does that. First of all, if you think that's the truth, then you obviously don't know anything about the history of this country or the real history of warfare in this country, okay? So yes, there are people that have deserted, and it's not as cut and dry as one would think. People go, well, if you deserted during a time of war, you should be shot. Well, okay, you could say that, and you might think that that's as patriotic and cut and dry as it gets, but what happens if it's a war like Iraq, where guys came home, they waited till they came home, and then they went AWOL? Should they be shot? Are they traitors because they didn't want to kill any more kids because maybe they were forced to shoot, you know, a 12-year-old kid because it was him or the kid, and the kid had an AK? And when the guy came home, he realized he wasn't mad at the kid with the AK, and to a certain extent, he wasn't even mad at himself. He was pissed off at the people that put him in that situation because it was either him or that kid. So he had to make that choice. And that's the choice that person has to live with for the rest of their life. And oftentimes, that's the one that makes them eat a bullet. War is not cool. So I understand why Bergdahl would lose his mind, but I also I can understand both sides of it. So at least with that argument, I can understand how it's that, you know, because that, you know, the raw emotion and what these soldiers have said and other veterans have said that the guy's a traitor, and rightfully so. If, you know, he did commit treason, technically what he did, if he did exactly what they think he did and what the evidence shows, then okay, technically he could be, they could break his balls for it. Now, that's a whole nother subject, which I'm going to get into next segment, about the whole political end of this thing and why it occurred or why it could have occurred when it occurred. But I understand why the veterans and the active duty guys are pissed off. And I can understand to a certain extent, I can understand why Bergdahl wouldn't want to kill people anymore and, you know, his views on being in Afghanistan and that it was wrong for them to be there. I can understand that. But I can't justify what he did by just leaving your fellow soldiers in danger like that. I just can't. That is, and it's not, well, I'm not saying, well, you're eating the, drinking the Kool-Aid, Popeye. No, I'm just saying I can't say that I agree with that. You put those guys in danger. You cause people's lives to be forever changed by getting shot, and they survived and they're crippled, and a lot of people are dead. So I'm sorry, I can't agree with it. Anyway, to balance out the argument, because there's a lot of that faux patriotism out there with this thing, I want to throw this amazing speech out there really quick from a member of Iraq Veterans Against the War. Take a listen.
And I tried hard to be proud of my service, but all I could feel was shame. And racism could no longer mask the reality of the occupation. These were people, these were human beings. I've since been plagued by guilt anytime I see an elderly man, like the one who couldn't walk, who we rolled onto a stretcher and told the Iraqi police to take him away. I feel guilt anytime I see a mother with her children, like the one who cried hysterically and screamed that we are worse than Saddam as we forced her from her home. I feel guilt anytime I see a young girl, like the one I grabbed by the arm and dragged into the street. We were told we were fighting terrorists. The real terrorist was me, and the real terrorism is this occupation. Racism within the military has long been an important tool to justify the destruction and occupation of another country. It has long been used to justify the killing, subjugation, and torture of another people. Racism is a vital weapon employed by this government. It is more important weapon than a rifle, a tank, a bomber, or a battleship. It is more destructive than an artillery shell, or a bunker buster, or a Tomahawk missile. While all those weapons are created and owned by this government, they are harmless without people willing to use them. Those who send us to war do not have to pull a trigger or lob a mortar round. They do not have to fight the war, they merely have to sell the war. They need a public who is willing to send their soldiers into harm's way. They need soldiers who are willing to kill and be killed without question. They can spend millions on a single bomb, but that bomb only becomes a weapon when the ranks in the military are willing to follow orders to use it. They can send every last soldier anywhere on earth, but there will only be a war if soldiers are willing to fight. And the ruling class, the billionaires who profit from human suffering, care only about expanding their wealth, controlling the world economy. Understand that their power lies only in their ability to convince us that war, oppression, and exploitation is in our interest. They understand that their wealth is dependent on their ability to convince the working class to die to control the market of another country. And convincing us to kill and die is based on their ability to make us think that we are somehow superior. Soldiers, sailors, Marines, airmen have nothing to gain from this occupation. The vast majority of people living in the U.S. have nothing to gain from this occupation. In fact, not only do we have nothing to gain, but we suffer more because of it. We lose limbs, endure trauma, and give our lives. Our families have to watch flag-draped coffins lowered into the earth. Millions in this country without health care, jobs, or access to education must watch this government squander over $450 million a day on this occupation. Poor and working people in this country are sent to kill poor and working people in another country to make the rich richer. And without racism, soldiers would realize that they have more in common with the Iraqi people than they do with the billionaires who send us to war. I threw families onto the street in Iraq, only to come home and find families thrown onto the street in this country, in this tragic and unnecessary foreclosure crisis. We need to wake up and realize that our real enemies are not in some distant land. They're not people whose names we don't know and cultures we don't understand. The enemy is people we know very well and people we can identify. The enemy is a system that wages war when it's profitable. The enemy is the CEOs who lay us off from our jobs when it's profitable. It's the insurance companies who deny us health care when it's profitable. It's the banks who take away our homes when it's profitable. Our enemy is not 5,000 miles away. They are right here at home. If we organize and fight with our sisters and brothers, we can stop this war, we can stop this government, and we can create a better world.
Well said. Go over to federaljack.com, download section Reality of War, or federaljack.com/war. You can download all the IVAW Winter Soldier testimony right there. If all the soldiers and all the Marines, sailors, and airmen in the world stopped and said we won't fight, war would end tomorrow. We'll be right back. We are back, ladies and gentlemen. So, last segment I explained with this whole Bo Bergdahl thing that I see this, you know, patriotic versus not patriotic, good to be a soldier fighting in Afghanistan, blah, 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 not focusing on the fact that a lot of the other soldiers in his unit did feel the same way, although they didn't act on, I don't want to say act on their impulses, because I'm sure, you know, some of them might have had those feelings, but they didn't, they not acted on it, but I can't say that all of them did. So they just didn't act on an impulse, we'll say, and take off. Now, again, I can understand why Bergdahl would be disillusioned, but I would never leave my friends in a hostile area. I understand that, you know, people that weren't in the military, can't understand this, but when you're out on a patrol or whenever you're doing anything, and the possibility of death is involved, you know, you're not sitting there, I've broken it down real easy. If you have two Marines in a foxhole and they're taking fire, or three Marines in a foxhole and they're taking fire, they're not sitting there while taking fire debating on Republican issues or Democrat issues, or, you know, if they think they're justified in even being there at the time. They might have that conversation, you know, while they're on patrol until they come under fire, and they might have that conversation afterwards. But when they're under fire, they're fighting, because that's when they're actually doing the fighting. They're fighting to keep the guy on the left and the guy on the right alive. They're not fighting for political reasons. Those are the bastards that send them there. They're the ones fighting for political reasons. We shouldn't be putting any of these guys in there to begin with. That was the whole point of the first segment, was me taking that, well, at least what I see being created out of this, and trying to beat that down. Now, the other side I want to get into, and there's a couple different avenues. This isn't by any means the end-all, be-all broadcast on this subject. This is just some of the things that I've noticed, and I decided that I wanted to at least... These need to be addressed first, and then, you know, the other stuff we could do in subsequent broadcasts, or even a breaking, you know, exclusive. Anyway, there's a few other things with this that I see. Now, one is the timing of the situation. We brought America's last POW home. No, you didn't. I'll be getting into that in other shows. I've done shows on that before, about missing POWs left to rot from Vietnam and even going back further. But anyway, they brought America's last POW in Afghanistan home. The Obama administration, ladies and gentlemen, perhaps he should have a third term. He killed bin Laden, got gay marriage passed, and ended the war in Iraq. What else could this miraculous healer do? Which, he's not responsible for any of that stuff, by the way. It's not like he did it. But because he's in office, it gets attributed to his name, and because he's got good PR people. You could break down each one of those individually, but that's the point. They're going for, he brought America's last POW home. Right at the time that they're having a scandal involving the Department of Veterans Affairs. So Shinseki resigns, and a couple days later, they bring Bergdahl home. They did it so fast that they didn't even inform Congress. They violated law and didn't inform Congress. And do you know how they handled that? We're sorry. Really? I guess I don't have to, you know, pay attention to laws anymore, right? I guess none of you do either, by the way. So I everybody should just, I guess, start breaking laws, because the president does it, his administration does it. They just do whatever they want, and they don't get held accountable. Well, the cops and everybody else are doing it, so why can't we? How come we're the only ones held accountable to law and nobody else is? They went so fast they didn't even notify Congress. What does that tell me? What does that tell me? Well, right off the bat, I would say that the administration might have been panicking and in red alert mode over the whole VA scandal. Scandal, please. He just got caught not doing what he said he was going to do and allowing it to continue to happen and perpetuating the problem. But they know that that's a big thing against him and a big ding in him and his side. It caused him a major problem. So, what do they do? What do they do? And if I remember correctly, it's a midterm election year. Interesting. Interesting how that happens. So yeah, this VA scandal. I'm looking at this and I say, wow. Heavy duty stuff, huh? And then suddenly I, breaking news. Bo Bergdahl brought home by the president. He does love veterans. Of course, I'm being facetious. You get my point. I was kind of living as though I was or impersonating one of the people in the general public watching television. So they see this VA scandal. And then suddenly Shinseki falls on the sword on a Friday. Commits seppuku. Right there. And then a couple days later, the last POW in Afghanistan is brought home. Now, I don't think it's just a cover. They didn't, you know, are you telling me they brought him home just to knock the veteran story out of the news cycle? Well, they've done other things, but it would not only knock it out of the news cycle, in a lot of ways it would also gum up the works of Congress, because now perhaps a lot of these special meetings and things that would have been maybe held, and I'm sure they still will be held, but perhaps some of these meetings and hearings they would have had are going to be postponed or moved to have hearings about what happened with them violating the rules and bringing Bergdahl home and doing all this other stuff. Now, why would they want to do that? Well, this is not conspiracy theory or anything. I'm just saying, if you have half a brain in your head, you wouldn't want, if you knew anything about depleted uranium and Shinseki and all that stuff, you wouldn't want that being looked into, right? You'd want to be able to steer the people that are looking into your stuff or paying attention to you away from what you're doing, even if it's just enough time that you can hide things or move things around. Three-card Monty if you're not paying attention to the card. So, there is that. Now, I'm not saying that that's exactly what happened. I don't know that to be fact at all. I'm just saying, sitting here looking at this, it's very convenient timing. Now, I don't think that they suddenly got a phone call from the Taliban and they were like, hey, let's do this. You know, they were working on this going back as far as 2011. So I think that they had this. I think this was one of those things that the White House was going to bring him home before 2016. I'm willing to bet Bergdahl was going to be brought home before 2016 no matter what. It's just a matter of what time or what incident was going to cause them to need to pull that card. I think that they've been having these talks with the Taliban behind the scenes for a while. I mean, look, these guys can be bought off by money. The Taliban, come on. Let's be honest. And it's not like an administration hasn't done this before for a political gain of, you know, one step, two step, maybe even three or four steps. Look at what the Reagan-Bush administration did. Or, I should say, the not even Reagan-Bush administration, the pre-Reagan-Bush administration. When Jimmy Carter was president, you know, the Iranian hostage crisis? They went behind the scenes and negotiated with the Iranians to not release the prisoners, because Jimmy Carter was working with them to get the prisoners released. And he was making headway, and it was going in that direction. And the not even in power Bush administration worked through back channels, Reagan-Bush administration, but it was really George H.W. Bush that ran things. Come on. Reagan gets almost assassinated, I think it was 6 to 8 weeks after he gets in the office. Really? 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 And the guy that assassinates him just happens, his family is good, close, personal friends with the Bush family. And George H.W. Bush was the vice president and would have become president if Reagan had died. I'm a conspiracy theorist just because I can see patterns, right? Mm-hmm. No, I'm a conspiracy factualist. Anyway, so you have a precedent set already in history that an administration would do something like this. And, you know, hey, you know, you guys have the hostages over there. Don't release them to Carter. Wait until Ronald Reagan gets into office and then release them. And that's exactly what they did. And then Reagan got the credit for releasing them. And, oh, my God, look, it was, you know, Reagan's a great guy and he's this mythical figure. And it was all a dog and pony show. It was wag the frigging dog to a certain extent. It wasn't a fake war, but I mean, they literally went in and hijacked a negotiation that the current administration was already in the process of doing, and they hijacked it for their own political agenda. So that being said, who's to say that the Bozo administration didn't, you know, calling him a bozo is not even a smart thing. Yeah, he could be an idiot. But I think a lot of that, I don't know, idiot persona, you know, a lot of that is fake. Of course he knew. You know, if I play stupid, you expect less of me, by the way. You get it? Well, I didn't know. It's not my fault. And it's also shirking responsibility. And then he can act like he's doing something about it. Plausible deniability, they call it. Right. Sure. So, who's to say that his administration didn't have Bergdahl, and not saying didn't have him, you know, they had him in a warehouse. Who's to say that they didn't have, you know, control of the situation or the people who had him? And, you know, they were just waiting for the proper time to pull it off. I mean, all of a sudden, out of nowhere, they, well, we got the chance and we took it. That's the way it works in these situations, Popeye. You don't know because you're not the president. You're not in the special forces. You wouldn't know. But this just so happens to coincide with this scandal, and it just so happens to knock any talk of the Veterans Administration problems completely out of the news cycle. I don't mean not being on page one. I mean, I don't even see it on page five, or virtual page five. You get my drift? It's not even being talked about again. What VA scandal? Our president loves the veterans, except now it's kind of falling back in his face because there's just all this backlash about Bergdahl, right? Now, the official administration standpoint on this whole thing is, well, we're kind of surprised that there's backlash about this whole thing. Now, that's the quote-unquote official, quote-unquote official administration stance on it. We're surprised. Now, let me ask you this. There's two ways you can go here. Maybe they really are surprised. They thought that they would pull this one out of their back pocket as like a, you know, like I said, they've had it sitting there. And it backfired on them because they didn't even bother to do a little bit of research on Bergdahl. Which, if you think about how elitist these people are and how arrogant they are to a certain extent, it wouldn't be beyond them to use a soldier as a political football without really knowing much about him. But you would think that the CIA or the Secret Service or somebody would without the president even asking, because that's what these advisors and stuff's job is to do, is to know all of this stuff about Bergdahl, right? So here's my problem with this. We didn't know, we got caught off guard, we're surprised that there's this negative backlash. And it very well could be because, they could have gotten caught off guard. It could be one of those mistakes, and this is what happens when you're rushing and things aren't planned, i.e., like I said, this happened very fast, so I think maybe they had it in their back pocket and they just pulled it out without – and if they did that, then maybe they would have skipped that step where they had somebody analyze things and, you know, take a fresh look at it, because maybe they hadn't looked at the subject for a while. It was just Bergdahl was, you know, in the arsenal of things that they could pull out and use. And somebody said, hey, let's bring him home. You know, what better of a way to completely show the opposite of, you know, you being against veterans? Oh, Obama hates vets, or the vets don't trust Obama. They think he's lying, blah, 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 blah. He didn't fulfill his promises. What's the best way? You know, and I'm not saying that for me. I'm saying that trying to look at it through the eyes of one of these, you know, PR people, one of these, you know, advisors to Obama, they would say to him, well, let's bring Bergdahl home. We've got that POW in Afghanistan, right? We still talk to the Haqqani network, right? Because it's kind of weird that that guy and a lot of soldiers and Marines have said this, that, and Special Forces guys especially, it's kind of odd that, I mean, the Haqqani network is supposedly one of the most brutal of these groups, and yet he survived all this time. So why was he able to survive all these years? And a lot of people were, maybe he's a CIA plant, maybe he's this, maybe he's that, maybe he became one of them. And if he defected, which some people have said, well, maybe he defected to the enemy. Okay. Maybe he decided he didn't want to fight anymore, and he was just, you know, his brain was that mentally affected by it, and at the time he did do that. But that still doesn't mean that the administration wouldn't have known that and tried to use that. And perhaps, but see, for me, I don't know if he could have defected. I think maybe he was PTSD'd out. PTS, I hate disorder, but you know what I mean? Brain was just battle fatigued, and maybe he, and I could be wrong, but maybe he was getting disillusioned, and at that time that seemed like the only reasonable solution to him. Well, even though it wasn't, maybe to him at the time it did. And again, I'm not justifying his actions. I'm using this because to explain what I'm talking about with, you know, them holding this in their back pocket. So he goes out there, and then once he's with the Taliban, and he realizes whether he got captured, picked up, they're talking with him, whatever. He realizes it's not as, you know, it's not what he thought, you know, oh God, right? So meanwhile, he's dealing with that on his own, right? But the administration, they find out, you know, they realize the Haqqani network has him, blah, 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 blah. They figure out a way to open lines of communication with them. And it's no secret that they've been having talks with the Taliban and these other networks and stuff, right? These other groups. So perhaps they opened up a back channel conversation with this group, and they worked out a way that they were feeding them money or whatever in order to keep Bergdahl as like a political card that they can pull whenever. And they would bring him home before 2016, but they would need him alive so that they make sure they have certain people in there. You know, they get introduced. They don't need traitors. You buy the group off. So maybe they gave the group money each month. You know, the State Department didn't want to talk about whether or not they were willing to trade money for Bergdahl's release. Wonder why that is. I mean, if, you know, people could say, well, because they wouldn't want to empower the enemy, because then the enemy would be, give us $1 billion. They'd be trying to kidnap soldiers. Okay, maybe to a certain extent. Maybe they don't want you looking into the idea of any money exchanging hands with the enemy, period, because that might lead you down the road of what I just said. Now, I don't have any physical evidence to back this up. This is just me seeing this whole situation the past few days and analyzing it, and understanding how the political machine works on the back end. Not allowing myself to get caught up in that emotional argument of, is he a traitor or is he not? Because that acts as a smokescreen and a lightning rod to take attention away from the other portion of this. So maybe the administration pulled him out like a political, you know, get out of jail free card, like they do with a bunch of other stuff, right? So maybe they pulled that out last minute. That's why you see some of these little mistakes here or there. And they pulled this card, and, you know, now they're getting backlash on it, and they're afraid that there's certain things that might come out. So they're doing damage control. They're taking on water in a few compartments, but rather than let the whole ship sink, they're just going to close off those compartments and allow them to fill with water, which you would do in a ship. And the sailors in those compartments better hope they get the hell out, because if they don't, you're going to be a permanent fixture of the ship until you get to dry dock, so to speak. And I could be wrong. My analysis could be completely off. I mean, again, I've done, you know, I've been paying attention to it, and I have been looking into it. I mean, when I say I haven't done much research, me not doing much research is, you know, for some people, doing research, you know, to me, skimming over stuff is reading 4 or 5 or 6 articles. Doing extensive research is actually, digging things up, trying to find stuff, you know, contacting people, things like that, having conversations with people. But from what I've looked into it, this is so far, this is just, and again, I'm not saying this is what it is. This is just what I see so far, and I could be wrong. But I see, and it's still, the picture is not completely clear, but there's certain things, it's like if I'm staring at, there's an image, let's pretend we're all in a room and we're looking at a wall, and there's a huge painting on this wall, but it's all blurry right now. But as, you know, and if you get too close, you're not going to see, I mean, it's already blurry, you're definitely not going to see the painting or anything. You have to step back far enough that you can focus on the whole painting. And suddenly, you'll notice little things. And when you start to notice those little things, you know, each little piece kind of, by you looking at it and analyzing it, unlocks another piece and makes it a little bit clearer and a little bit clearer until suddenly the entire picture is in full view right in front of your face. And you see everything. Or at least enough to have enough evidence to want you to even look further, or you enough for you to see the truth. Even if it's not the entire truth, it exposes itself. So I see a lot of political jockeying going on with this thing. I see, perhaps to a certain extent, the administration getting caught with their pants down because they rushed this. And the question room, there's a lot of questions, not the question. There's a lot of questions that now, you know, pop up because of this. Is anybody going to try to hold them accountable for violating, you know, law and not notifying Congress? I mean, they've already violated other laws, so does that matter? Is anybody going to question whether or not this was done as a political move, or is that going to get swept under the rug? Are people going to allow the VA to be forgotten about and the Veterans Administration problems to be forgotten about because Shinseki fell on the sword, so, you know, it's all fixed now? He quit, so that all of a sudden veterans are like, oh, I woke up today and all my problems were fixed as a disabled veteran. No, they weren't. Of course they weren't. Let's be real. So just the timing I question. There's a lot of politics to it. And to me, it would behoove them to allow, remember, the media is their lapdog, so to me, it would behoove them to allow their media to focus on the argument of, is Bergdahl a traitor or is he not a traitor? And I've kept my personal feelings out of this whole thing because I can't give you a fair analysis if I turn on my emotions and allow any of my personal feelings to cloud my judgment or my logic. There's a lot to this. I don't think it's as simple as people think it is. And that's why I think the administration wanted to keep it simple so they could use it as a political football. Like I said, it's like playing a game of Monopoly and you have a couple of those, you know, cards that you get from the chance deck, or the other one, was it community chest? And you get like a get out of jail free card, or, you know, whatever. And sometimes some of the cards you can pull out whenever you want. That's what they got. They got a bunch of those. They have a couple get out of jail free cards, you know, or whatever you want to call it. And whenever they need to, whenever something comes up, because I said this on Facebook the other day. I said, isn't it kind of odd that whenever there's a scandal with this administration or some sort of issue, there's always a mass shooting or some other big event, and it takes the heat off of them. Just an observation. Anyway, we're out of time, ladies and gentlemen. Use your brains. Think. Don't be quick to react based off of emotion. Always take a day or two, sit back and think about the bigger picture. Put on those Hoffman sunglasses.
This is Sparta!
We are out of time until tomorrow. As I tell you each night, ladies and gentlemen, the solutions to our problems are an inside job. Be the superhero that I know each and every one of you has inside of you. You're all amazing. I love all of you, and I'll catch you all again tomorrow night. I'm out.